Good morning, everybody. So I'll be presenting the KEYNOTE-048. This is a phase III study of first-line pembrolizumab for recurrent and metastatic head and neck squamous cell carcinoma. Here are my disclosures. Once head and neck cancer has recurred or become metastatic, for the majority of patients, there are not curative local therapies, and the majority of these patients receive systemic therapy, usually chemotherapy or cetuximab, as we heard, and can expect a median survival of under a year. The standard regimen is the extreme regimen, which is a combination of cisplatin, 5-fluorouracil, and cetuximab. But it's recognized that the immune checkpoint inhibitors, including pembrolizumab and nivolumab, have activity in head and neck cancer, and both pembrolizumab and nivolumab are FDA approved in the second line setting. In thinking about how to begin to study immune checkpoint inhibition in the first line setting, that is to say, as the first systemic therapy that a patient receives when the cancer recurs or becomes metastatic, we considered the fact that PD-L1 expression in tumor has been associated with a higher response rate, better sensitivity to immune checkpoint inhibitors, as well as the fact that chemotherapy has been proposed as a rational combination with immune checkpoint inhibitors. It can disrupt tumor architecture and maybe improve accessibility of the immune system to the tumor, and it induces rapid disease control and has a higher response rate than immune checkpoint inhibitors given as monotherapy. So we wish to determine whether pembrolizumab alone or in combination with chemotherapy would be superior to treatment with the standard of care regimen, extreme, in an all-comers patient population, as well as looking at those patients who were biomarker-enriched because their tumors expressed the marker PD-L1. The primary endpoints of the study were overall survival and progression-free survival in patients with a PD-L1 combined positive score of greater than or equal to 20, a combined positive score of greater than or equal to 1, and all patients enrolled. And let me just define for you what the combined positive score was. It was a ratio of all the PD-L1 positive tumor cells, lymphocytes, and macrophages to the total number of cells that you had counted times 100. Patients were eligible who had squamous cell carcinoma of the oral cavity, oropharynx, larynx, or hypopharynx, whose recurrent metastatic disease was not amenable to curative local therapy. They had to have good performance status, tissue had to be available for PD-L1 testing, and if the cancer had arisen in the oropharynx, they had to have known P16 status because, as you just heard from Dr. Mahena, those patients with HPV-associated cancer have a better prognosis. Patients were stratified by their tumor's expression of PD-L1, their P16 status, and their ECOG performance status, and they were randomized 1:1:1 to pembrolizumab monotherapy, to a novel regimen of pembrolizumab together with a platinum chemotherapy, 5-fluorouracil, followed after 6 cycles by pembrolizumab monotherapy, or to the extreme regimen given for 6 cycles followed by cetuximab monotherapy. And what we found was that in patients who had elevated biomarker, CPS-20, using pembrolizumab alone as first-line therapy was superior to the extreme regimen with an improvement in median survival, a hazard ratio of 0.61, and that was statistically significant. Median overall survival improved from 10.7 to 14.9 months, and the benefit was durable. At 2 years, survival was 22% with the extreme regimen and 38% for those patients who had started with pembrolizumab monotherapy. Similarly, in patients who were biomarker-enriched with having a CPS of 1 or higher, pembrolizumab was superior to the extreme regimen, extending median survival from 10.3 to 12.3 months. Again, the effect was durable, so at 2 years, 19% of extreme-treated patients and 30% of pembrolizumab-treated patients were alive. The hazard ratio here was 0.78, and it was statistically significant. Turning now to the comparison of pembrolizumab with chemotherapy, so the regimen of pembrolizumab chemotherapy compared to the extreme regimen, this time in the total population without biomarker selection. This was also, the novel regimen was also superior to the extreme regimen, extending median survival from 10.7 to 13 months. Again, this benefit persisted at 2 years with 19% of extreme treated patients and 29% of patients treated with the novel regimen alive. The hazard ratio was 0.77. This was statistically significant. There are additional, this is an interim analysis that was pre-planned at a certain duration of follow-up. There are further analyses still to be forthcoming, including whether or not pembrolizumab monotherapy is superior to the extreme regimen in a biomarker unselected patient population. At this interim analysis, we know that pembrolizumab was non-inferior to the extreme regimen. Neither pembrolizumab nor pembrolizumab plus chemotherapy improved response rate over the extreme regimen, but when patients responded, they had a longer duration of response. Pembrolizumab alone had a better safety profile than the extreme regimen, and pembrolizumab plus chemotherapy had a comparable safety profile to the extreme regimen. So, pembrolizumab alone and pembrolizumab given with platinum and 5-fluorouracil should represent new standards of care for the first-line treatment of recurrent metastatic head and neck carcinoma. Immune checkpoint monotherapy with pembrolizumab allows patients to live longer and has a better safety profile than the previous standard of care for those patients whose tumors express PD-L1. Adding the immune checkpoint inhibitor to pembrolizumab to platinum-based chemotherapy has a comparable response rate and allows patients to live longer compared with the standard of care. And pembrolizumab can be safely added to platinum-based chemotherapy. There are further analyses of biomarker and clinical predictors that will be forthcoming from this study, and these may eventually optimally guide the choice of whether to administer pembrolizumab alone or in the novel combination. And obviously, this work would not have been possible without the participation of the 882 brave patients who enrolled, and we thank them and their families. Thank you very much.